I think that's something really big.
I think we should send a mail to someone.
An email to someone? Did I miss anything?
Everywhere, most of the time we're unaware, but horses know we're leaking all the time. When looking in the fridge, when coughing does the bidding bridge, your sardinals for fun and for the prize, cause sardinals are with us all the time.
See? The new eviction strategies that takes the slice into account is a lot faster than the old one.
Oh, that looks good. But how does it work?
Think about it. If you have a 16-way cache and you want to evict it, you would probably just evict each of these ways. You would have a set that occupies each of them.
But then the victim does something, accesses one of the ways, and that's slower.
Yeah. And you could measure that. You could time the victim. That's called an evictant time attack then. You evict the cache set and then check whether the victim runs fast or slow.
Mm-hmm. But in our case, we do not time the victim. So how could we extract information?
Think about Lucas' flush and flush attack. There, we didn't measure the time of the victim, but we measured the time of the flush. So it was slower if someone in the meantime changed something in the cache, loaded a cache line.
And for eviction, we kind of do the same thing. We occupy all of the ways in the cache set, and if we later access them again, we can see if someone else accessed it in the meantime.
Yeah. So there are two cases here. Either your data is already in the cache, then accessing it in the eviction will be fast.
Mm-hmm.
Or if someone else kicked something out from your eviction set, then it will be slower to access it.
Did someone of you take a bottle out of the fridge?
No.
Why?
Here all the time.
I put the bottle in the fridge and now it was standing next to it on the counter.
Ooh, that's exactly like in the attack we found. You try to access the bottle from the fridge, but someone took it out, so it will now take more time until you get your drink.
Way more time. It's not chilled at all now. I will find out who takes the bottle out of the fridge.
Lucas, this was just a histogram, right? But if you plug this into the AES attack from a few weeks ago.
Sure.
Okay. Kind of works, but why is this inverted?
Right, because for flush and reload, the slow case was when the victim did not access the cache. But for Prime and Probe, the slow case is when they did access the cache.
So this eviction set, how do you generate this?
Exactly like we said. So we take many addresses, we compute the slice they're in, and then we take the set.
The set, how do you know which set they're in?
It's just bit 7 to 17. It's a completely linear mapping.
These addresses, are they just completely random addresses?
Well, not completely random. You take addresses that are already good candidates based on the lower 12 bits that match between the virtual and the physical address.
But for this cache set, do you then verify based on the physical address whether they fall into the same cache set?
Right, yeah. And they're also 64-byte aligned, they're cache line aligned.
Yeah. And That's not what I meant. The thing is, you use mmap here, and you map this shared library from OpenSSL into your memory. So you have shared memory with the victim.
And?
You don't access it, and you don't flush it.
So you mean this could work without shared memory?
Yeah.
Huh. That could have a huge impact. That could be an attack as powerful as flush and reload.
But without shared memory. So with this attack, if we have this, then it works. And you didn't access it. And you didn't flush.
Wait, what do you mean you didn't flush?
I didn't flush?
Dude, what?
Right?
It's great. We can show you. But in virtual machines don't have shared memory.
Well, that's not entirely correct. There's a concept called page deduplication.
Mm-hmm.
The hypervisor runs a kernel thread, which scans for identical pages. Once an identical page pair is found, it gets deduplicated, so they point to the same physical page. And once one of these two processes would override the page, mm-hmm. then copy and write comes into play.
But today that is rarely used, right?
Hypervisors are still using that.
Really? In the cloud?
In the cloud, yes.
But not across virtual machines, right?
No, not across them, but within a single virtual machine, it is still active.
And that is still exploitable?
Yes. We showed that actually in a remote scenario, over 14 hops across the internet.
The actual internet?
Yes, indeed. Over 14 hops, a multiple thousand kilometers away.
Wow.
That's impressive.
Yeah, but back to
crazy.
The point. Flush and reload usually doesn't work across VMs.
They usually don't share memory across virtual machines. And that means flush and reload doesn't work, but this new attack could work across virtual machines.
Since this attack should work across virtual machine boundaries,
mm-hmm.
let me remove this shared library here.
But wait, if you remove the shared library, how do you find the right cache set then?
Oh, I just print the address in the victim.
That doesn't sound very realistic for an attack.
Oh, but there are only 2048 sets per slice.
Yeah.
So you can just scan through them and look for the 92% of AES.
Oh, the one that we saw some weeks ago when scanning AES.
Exactly.
The ratio, the probability that a cache line is accessed in a T-table.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, fair enough, yeah.
So, yeah, so there it is.
Oh, this looks identical to before.
So Andreas, Martin and Claudia are not at home. So it's either you or Manuel that takes my drink out of the fridge.
No.
It must be Manuel.
But maybe you could use this fridge side channel to recover some more information, something secret. For instance, when someone gets up in the morning.
Mm-hmm.
We should tell a side channel professor about this.
Okay.
Maybe I can write my thesis about this.
Please, no insider jokes. No one will get this.
But it's public information, right? Lucas' master thesis was a substantial part of the Hello from the Other Side paper. And
please don't add the music video.
But the viewers can find it on YouTube if they want to, right? Hello from the Other Side was a quite ambitious paper, actually. The academic community had a lot of papers about side channels and covert channels at the time. And they were usually evaluated by measuring the performance of the covert channel, the capacity. So you transmit data from one process to another process, or maybe from one virtual machine to another virtual machine. And you measure the raw capacity there and the bit error rate.
Pretty much like for network transmission.
Yeah, exactly. But there was no work showing how difficult it is to get from a raw capacity and the bit error rate to an actual reliable zero error transmission. So our goal was to make it so reliable that you can tunnel an SSH connection through the cache covert channel. And that was using the prime and probe technique.
Ah, and prime and probe is what we are discovering in the sitcom right now.
Exactly.
Actually, it was quite some effort to make a prime and probe channel, which is fairly noisy, mm-hmm. resilient.
Yeah. So actually, you have different types of errors there. You have substitution errors. With substitution errors, the transmission did not work, right? You get the wrong bit there. Insertion errors, where a sender maybe hasn't been scheduled for instance, and then you get added bits in there in the receiver side. And deletion errors, where the receiver was not scheduled, and then you miss some of the bits that the sender sent.
You also don't have a shared reliable clock.
Yeah.
We used a protocol with acknowledgement there, and based on that, the sender and receiver synchronize themselves. And then we have several layers of error correction, so parity bits on the first, and then read Solomon codes on the second.
And that was stable enough for SSH connections, which fail if there is a single corrupted bit in a transmission. And it was fast enough so that Michael Schwarz and Manuel Weber have been able to transmit a music video live on stage at Black Hat Asia from one side to the other on the Amazon cloud. Give me a second.
No.
I don't know. I really like the music video. Yeah. I'm sure you can write a master thesis about this. So I had a really good idea for a name. Evict and evict. Like flush and flush, but with eviction.
That's not a good name.
We need a good name for this. Maybe time and evict.
I think that's too similar to evict and time.
I'll check with Professor Mangard whether he's there and has time, maybe.
If he has time, I'll be ready in a minute.
Sounds good.
What would be a good name for an attack where you fill the cache line, wait a bit, and then check if some other activity kicked out the cache line?
Prime and probe.
Ah, that's not a good name. We just measure the time of some eviction loop.
No, the attack you just described, it is called prime and probe.
What? No, why would it be called prime and probe?
Yeah, because first you prime the cache, you put in your own cache lines, and then you probe it. It means you reaccess the cache lines and you measure how long it takes.
But that's the same step.
No, it doesn't have to be. Like, yes, you can implement it in the same way, but you don't have to. You could probe the cache in reverse order or just use fewer cache lines. There are so many possibilities.
So I talked with Professor Mangard and I told him we have this new side channel with huge impact. And he said, well, for this, he has time for a quick meeting now. What? Oh, no.
No. No. Cache attacks and countermeasures. The case of AES. So, Ospik et al. Coined the term prime and probe.
Yeah.
But in 2009, Riesenbart et al. Showed an attack on the level 3 cache. And in 2015, Maurice et al. Reverse engineered the slice functions. So, we have found nothing new today.
So I finally made it. You mentioned you found something really big. So what is it?
Actually, we just figured out that the attack already exists and is called prime and probe.
We'll never find a new attack.
You shouldn't get frustrated about it. You know, this is the usual thing that happens in research, right? So it's like at the beginning, you come there and then you look there and it somehow looks like everything is solved. But it just means you need to dig deeper, right? So if you look at a very high perspective, you could say there are no problems on this earth. But you need to dig for the problems, right? So you need to find out where the problems are. And then you will find out, okay, you suddenly find an idea that was maybe published 10 years ago. And then you think more on it, or you read in the literature and you get closer and closer to the actual problems that we are facing today. I mean, actually, it's a good thing that you found something that already somebody else found, because it means you're on a good track, right? It means you share the same thoughts, but in order to get them to a nice publication, you have to go one step beyond that. So you have to find the difference, right? So you have to find a different setting, a new approach, a new methodology, maybe a new idea. You have to get something fresh in there in order to get to really something new, because that's what we are after, right?
Yeah, I really wanted to add that there, because that was advice that Stefan Mangard gave me when I was a PhD student, actually, in the first year.
So just spend more time on this, and I'm pretty sure in a few days you will come with another great idea.
Yeah, thanks.
So see you around.
Yeah, bye.
Bye.
All right. There was one more thing I wanted to try. It was Prime and Probe across virtual machines.
Which cache set do you attack then?
We already thought about this. You can just search through all of them, for all the sets, basically template the cache.
Ooh, yes.
Yeah, and especially for a cache covert channel, that would be easy. Mm-hmm. The sender jams one set with eviction the entire time, mm-hmm. and the receiver probes through the sets as part of their prime probe attack.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, and if they jam the same cache sets, they both see it in the timings.
That's brilliant.
And that's really just a simple trick from the Hello from the Other Side paper.
Okay, so you're building a covert channel now?
Exactly. I have two virtual machines here, one on the left and one on the right. And if everything works, they should be able to communicate.
Hello. You received hello from the other side. Fun fact, this was actually what Michael Schwarz transmitted as a test message. And if I remember it correctly, also the origin of the idea for the Hello from the Other Side music video we produced.
You're not playing it now. No.
And even if it's not a new attack, I think there's still a lot of things we can do with it. Like Stefan Mangard said, we could change the environment, choose a different target.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Also, this templating approach, I think this is really interesting and could be very powerful. Maybe I write a paper about this. I could really see it. Cache template attacks.
That sounds interesting. I also have a timing difference I can't explain.
The basis of Prime and Probe and other cache attacks is resource contention.